إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله تعالى من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهدي الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم تسليمًا كثيرًا. أما بعد، tonight I want to talk about a very important topic that I think is essential for every Muslim, male and female. And that is the topic of loving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, I'm going to go inshallah to the root word, al-hub in Arabic, because that is the word mentioned in the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. And then inshallah, I'll talk about the types of love. And then the most important part is how we can increase our love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So I'll mention a few steps and few, methods of how we can improve and increase our love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All this in half an hour inshallah. First, if we look and examine the word hub in Arabic, and by the way, the Arabic language, some scholars mentioned that the word hub, if you look at the word, it's made of two letters, ha and ba. Now, if you notice, if you try to pronounce the ha, where does it come from? If you can say it. It comes from the very bottom of the throat. What about the ba? It's on the very top of the lips. So really, it encompasses all the letters, all the alphabets. Now, some scholars mentioned that because the Arabs could not define love, they could not come up with a word that defines love, they came up with this word hub because it encompasses all the letters of the alphabets. What are the roots of the word hub? I'll talk about four different meanings or roots of the word hub. The first one comes from habab al-ma, which means like the bubbles or the foam on top of the water. And that is because love, you know, is something that has to be supreme. It has to be on top of everything else. That is true love. It has to be a priority. True love is something that is superior and it, you know, floats, it's on top of everything else. The second meaning comes from habab al-asnan, which is the whiteness of the teeth. Because again, love represents purity. I mean, if love is divided, if somebody has love to many things, that love is not devoted, is not dedicated, and as a result, is not pure. But true love is pure and devoted. The third meaning, or the third root, if you will, comes from حَبَّ الْإِبِلِ, which means when the camels sit down. Now, usually to the Arabs, the sitting of the camel represents longevity. It represents stability because it sits for a long time. Likewise, love, the true love, is not temporary. The true love is stable, and it's long-living, it's long-lasting. For example, when you talk about the love between a husband and a wife, it is not a love that is temporary. In fact, it is a love, the true love is something that comes with time. And this is why true love in a marriage will increase over time, because it's based on a good company and all of that, not something temporary. The last root of love, or hub in Arabic, comes from the word hab, which means a grain or a seed. Now, the grain or the seed is the essence of the fruit. It is the core of the fruit. Likewise, love. Love is the essence of everything. Now, when it comes to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because the topic tonight is loving Allah, we're not talking about loving other beings. If we apply all of these meanings, let us see what happens. The first meaning, The love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has to be superior. It has to be more than any other love. So the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has to exceed all other types of love. As Muslims, we should love Allah more than anyone else. And it should be clear to all Muslims that this is the number one priority. The love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is high and above all other loves. Number two, the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala should be pure. We love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala purely. We should devote our love to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number three, the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the core of our worship. It is the core of our worship. So if a worship does not have the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's like a dead corpse. You know, any worship that is void of the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's like a body without a soul. It doesn't have, it is not life. It's considered dead. So this is the importance of love. It's central to our worship. Likewise, the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala should be continuous. It should not be temporary. It should be long-lasting. Now, if we talk about the, you know, love, it is different types. The type of love that we are supposed to direct to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is called حب العبادة. It is the love that is combined with submission. Because when we talk about love, some people think, well, maybe it's like the love we have between people. No, it should not be like that. The love between us and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the love that exists between a servant and a master or a lord. And this is why the scholars call it حب العبادة or حب التذلل. And Ibn al-Qayyim has a poetry. He says, وعبادة الرحمن غاية حبه مع ذل عابده هما قطبان. He was talking about this love and he said, really the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is made of two elements. It is the utmost love. So, the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the utmost love combined with submission and humility. And these are, like he said, qutbani. They're the foundations. They're the two poles, the two pillars of worship. When you combine this pure love, the utmost love, غايت حبه, like the utmost love with submission, then this is the kind of love that we should direct to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, obviously, there are other types of love. For example, as a father, you love your children. As a mother, you love your children. Well, that's called حب الشفقة, for example. That is a love combined with mercy and compassion. Or the love you have toward a weak man, a weak woman, a poor man, a sick woman, etc. That's حب الشفقة. You feel compassion and mercy toward these people. Likewise, the love you have to your parents. That's حب ال, like, you know, they say the love of respect. You know, you love them, that love is combined with respect and honor. You honor your parents and so forth. There's also الحب الطبيعي, the natural love. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us with certain inclinations. Like we all love to, you know, drink water or tea, or we love food, we love to eat, especially in Ramadan. We love, you know, to have a nice house, a nice car. This is something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created within us. It's natural, it's totally halal and permissible. In fact, all these types of love, except the first one, are considered halal and permissible. The first one is an obligation. To love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with that submission is an obligation. The others are halal and permissible. Now, if you change your intention and make it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even those types of love will turn into acts of worship. For example, your love of your parents. If you do it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because everyone loves their parents. You know, you could be a criminal and you love your parents. But if you do it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you obey your parents, you love them for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, now that love turned into an act of worship. Likewise, you love your children for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that love turns into an act of worship. Loving food even. If you say, I'm going to eat, and my intention is so that I can worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala longer, so I can serve Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, serve the community, do more charity. Now that permissible act turns into an act of worship. But we have to remember that the most important love, the original love, the origin of all love is the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So keep that in mind. And this is why when we talk about the different types of love, the scholars say, Hubbullah is number one. And then we have Al-Hubb Fillah, that you love someone for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So now, for example, you love the prophets for the sake of Allah. You love the good people, the pious people, for the sake of Allah. You love your parents, your children, your friends, for the sake of Allah. All of that could be considered Al-Hubb Fillah. Now there is a third type of love, which is not good. Okay, so far we talked about the love which is good. And that is called Al-Hubb Ma'Allah. If you love someone along with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so that love is competing with your love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then that is a problem. That is a problem. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, in fact, in the Quran, he told us about this type of love, which is competing with the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For example, he said, وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَتَّخِذُ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ أَنْدَادًا يُحِبُّونَهُمْ كَحُبِّ اللَّهِ. So some people, he said, they take partners with Allah. In fact, they're committing shirk. And here, he's not talking about, prostrating to an idol. He's not talking about, worshiping some idol and so forth. He's talking about love only. He said some people, they make shirk in their love. What do they do? It says, يُحِبُّونَهُمْ كَحُبِّ اللَّهِ. So they're setting up idols, partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nid is a partner or an equal. And their problem is they love them like they love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the same manner that they love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So basically, they're loving them, this love which is hub al-ta'zim, hub al-ibadah, etc. They're loving them in the same way, in the same manner that they love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then it says, وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَشَدُّ حُبَّا لِلَّهِ. But the believers have far greater love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because their love is pure. It is dedicated to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is not divided. It is not confused. It is dedicated to Allah and Allah alone. So this type of love is not good. And the Quran, in fact, refutes it and does not accept it. Now, inshallah, what I want to do, and this is really the focus of this talk, we want to talk about certain ways to improve our love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because I think every Muslim, before anything else, we should try our best to improve our love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We do all these acts of worship, they're great. We do, taraweeh, we do qiyam, all of this. But if our love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not increasing, if these acts of worship are void or they have little love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in them, then maybe they're not as efficient, they're not as effective. So if we inject love in all these acts and if we improve our love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then all our acts of worship will be improving. It will be much better. And it'll be better in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So and I'm not going to be comprehensive, I'm not going to mention every possible way of improving, increasing our love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but I'll mention maybe 7 or 8 ways or methods to increase our love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The first way, inshallah, to improve and increase our love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to recite the Qur'an. Now, when I say recitation of the Qur'an, I don't just mean like you recite. Alhamdulillah, nowadays, mashallah, we have so many people, they memorize the Quran by the verse number. You say, verse 150 of Surah An-Nisa, they'll tell you right away. But I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about contemplating on the meanings of the Quran. أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked us, all of us, that's like a rhetorical question. Don't they ponder upon the Qur'an? Don't they contemplate? Don't they reflect and think about the meanings of the Qur'an? أَمْ عَلَى قُلُوبٍ أَقْفَالُهَا. Or is there like seals on the hearts? Is there like a lock or a seal on the heart? That is a rhetorical question in the Quran. So here it's asking us to not just read it, not just recite it, but to contemplate and think. And that is the kind of recitation that will bring the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I think a common mistake when we read the Quran, what happens? We approach the Quran with preconceived ideas. Like we already made up our minds about certain concepts. And then we read the Quran and we try to explain the Quran in the way that suits us. We want to understand the Quran in a matter that suits our understanding. But this is not going to help us. If we really want to benefit from the Quran, we should approach the Quran with an open mind. Like I am totally neutral, I open the Quran, whatever it tells me, I believe and I practice. So let the Quran teach you. Don't inject your understanding to the Quran. Don't impose your understanding onto the Quran. Because then it's not going to really help you. You're going to lose the benefit of the Quran. So to improve your love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you open the Quran and you tell the Quran, you teach me, I'm not going to teach you. I'm not going to impose my ideas. You're going to, inshallah, teach me, and I want Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to teach me. Whatever I see, whatever I hear from Allah, I believe in, I take it, I practice it as much as I can, but I'm not going to reject it. I'm not going to change it or modify it to suit my desires. So that's number one. Number two, to increase our love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is to do a lot of nafil. Now what is nafil? Nafil is not just voluntary prayers. Nafil is any voluntary act. It could be voluntary fast, it could be a voluntary sadaqah, charity. Any voluntary act will increase your love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we know in the hadith Qudsi, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَلَا يَزَالُ عَبْدِي يَتْقَرَّبُ إِلَيَّ بِالنَّوَافِلْ حَتَّى أُحِبَّهُ. That my servant will keep doing these extra acts, these voluntary acts of worship, until I love him. Alhamdulillah, all of us, I hope, all of us do the obligations. This is the bare minimum. But in order to accomplish the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you got to do something more. You got to do something extra. It's not enough just to do the bare minimum. Somebody might say, well, doesn't Allah love everybody anyways? I mean, some people say Allah loves everybody. God loves everyone. I mean, that's something that a lot of people say. God loves everyone. Here I'm talking about a special love. Yes, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves everyone in the sense that, He provides for everyone. It doesn't matter. You could be the worst criminal on earth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala still gives you food and water and air to breathe. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not discriminate in that sense. He gives everybody. He loves everybody in that sense. But here I'm talking about the special love. Not everybody deserves or earns the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a special way. Not all the Muslims even. Only few selected people will earn the special love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that's what I'm talking about. So that the second method is to improve or increase our voluntary acts. This will earn us the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The third way is dhikr. To remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And wallahi, when we talk about Islam, it's all common sense. Because let me ask you, if you love anyone, but you never think of them, is that really true love? I mean, you claim you love someone, but you never think of them. If you truly love someone, you think of them all the time. Even if you want to forget, you cannot forget. You try to sleep, you think of them. You wake up, you think of them. That is true love. So what about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? That is really the essence of dhikr. That you remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on a regular basis. That is a sign of a true love. That you remember Allah, you mention Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on your tongue, you're always mindful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you're conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's a hadith that says, أَنَا مَعَ عَبْدِي مَا ذَكَرَنِي وَتَحَرَّكَتْ بِي شَفَتَاهُ. That I am with my servant as long as he remembers me and his lips are busy mentioning my name. So by mentioning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on a regular basis, that will increase your love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because you're remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala all the time. But if you don't remember, if you don't mention the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you don't make any dhikr, and you forget about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, out of mind, out of sight, you don't think about it, you know, it's not gonna, you know, increase your relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So dhikr is very important, and it's very practical to improve and increase your love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, saying subhanallah, alhamdulillah, any type of dhikr, very easy. The easiest thing in Islam is to say subhanallah, alhamdulillah. You know, some scholars say that even if you cannot recite Fatiha, for the people who cannot recite Fatiha, like they're new Muslims and they don't know Arabic, some scholars say, instead of Fatiha, you can say subhanallah, alhamdulillah, and you make dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Some scholars. So, you know, dhikr is very important and it is very easy. So that is number three, right? Number four. One way to increase our love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to do what we call ithar. What is ithar? Sometimes in life, we are presented with different options. And you know, one option is what Allah loves. And the other option is what you love. Like you're, you know, you love it, you desire it. But they're in conflict. Now, some people choose to follow their desires. But other people choose to love what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves. If you do that, it will increase your love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look at the month of Ramadan, and it's a common example. And it's, you know, maybe an easy one versus other examples. But in the month of Ramadan, you're presented with two choices. Either you eat and drink in the day of Ramadan, which is what you like and love. You love food, you want to drink water, you love water. But then you know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not like that you drink and eat during the day of Ramadan. Now all of us, alhamdulillah, what do? We choose what Allah loves over what we love. So this is called ithar. Now, that's probably a common example, but there are other examples in life, and you're going to face it after Ramadan. You're going to be presented with choices. And you know some of them Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala likes and loves. And they're in contradiction with your desires. Now, some people, what they're going to do, they're going to choose their desires over what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves. And other people, they will choose what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves over what they love. If they do that, if you do that, inshallah, you're going to earn the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you're going to increase the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in your heart. So ithar is very important. And really, it's in a way, it is a test of your faith. What do you like more? Is it your desire, or it is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from you? Are we counting? How many do we have so far? Four or five? Four? Okay. I trust you. I'm not counting, so. Four. So the fifth way to increase our love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to get to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I mean, how can you, again, I'm talking about common sense. How can you love someone and you don't know them? Can you imagine loving something or someone and you have no clue who they are, what they are? You have no idea what their qualities are. You know, this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us so much about himself in the Quran. He told us, he gave us his names and at least some of his names and attributes. This is so that we can increase our love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When we learn that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has the most beautiful names, al-asma'ul husna, yani al-mutanahiya fil husn, the most perfect and beautiful names and attributes, wa-sifat al-ula, the highest attributes, the most perfect attributes, that will make us love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because by nature, we love what is beautiful, we love what is perfect. This is common sense. Even in life, the reason you love someone else, one of the reasons you love something else or someone else is because of their beautiful qualities. Some people are attracted to physical qualities, and some others are attracted to you know other qualities. Like people have good morals, good characters, and you love them for that. So what about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So the reason you want to learn about the names and attributes is to increase your love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there's a hadith that says, "Inna Allah jamilun yuhibbul jamal." That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, has these beautiful attributes in a way that befits His majesty. We don't compare His beauty to our beauty. The human beauty is different. But He said that He loves beauty. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves beauty. And He created that thing in us. So we love beauty anytime we see it. And this is why when we learn about the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we realize how great they are, how beautiful they are, how perfect they are, we're going to start loving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala much better than before. We're going to increase our love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's number five, right? Number six. One way to increase our love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to think about His bounties, His favors, His blessings upon us. Again, human nature. If somebody did a favor to you, even a small favor, even if they don't have any good qualities, let's say they're ugly, whatever, but they did a good, you know, a good deed. They came to you, opened the door for you, did you a favor, maybe a small favor. Now you love them for their actions. Not for their attributes, but for their actions. Likewise, when it comes to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, think, all the favors are coming from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَمَا بِكُم مِّن نِعْمَةٍ فَمِنَ اللَّهِ There is not a single bounty you have. There is not a single blessing or favor that you have except that it comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَإِن تَعُدُّ نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا If you try to enumerate and count the bounties of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you cannot do that. There's so many. You can't. I mean, you count few. You count 10, 20, 30, 40, 100. There are thousands and thousands of bounties. We just cannot think of all of them. But when you think about that, it will increase your love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because of His continuous favors upon us. And again, this is human nature. If somebody did a small favor and we love them so much, what about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who did so much for us? And this is something that everybody, and it's not, you know, rocket science. I mean, even children can be taught like that. They can be taught to love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because of these things. And we should be, it should be part of our training, our children, to teach them how to love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't just, you know, wait and, you know, you think that it's going to just come. You know, these are things that you can train yourself, you train others to do in order to develop this love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But that is a very important part. So that's six. Six, you're counting. Good. Number seven. Inshallah, we'll have two more. Inshallah, we can conclude. Because the idea is not to, you know, count every possible way of increasing our love. But these are things, inshallah, I think very common, and I think all of us can do. Another important way of increasing our love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to find a good company. Now, there's a beautiful dua we know in the sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam that is really the secret of this method. You see, in one dua, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam taught us to say, Allahumma inni as'aluka hubbak. Oh Allah, it's all about love. This dua is all about love. We should, you know, learn it and we should repeat it all the time. It says, Allahumma inni as'aluka hubbak. Oh Allah, I ask you that you allow me to love you, that you teach me to love you, that you let me love you and increase my love of you. Allahumma inni as'aluka hubbak. Wa hubba man ahabbak. And to allow me to love the people that you love. Or to allow me to love the people that love you. So it's not just it's not just loving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's also loving the people that love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And by loving the people that love Allah, you can increase your love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So keeping a good company will have positive effects on you. And one of them is it will increase your love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the same dua, it says, وَأَسْأَلُكَ حُبَّ عَمَلٍ يُقَرِّبُنِي إِلَى حُبِّكَ And that will take us to number eight. It says, and I ask you to allow me to love an action that will make me near you, or will draw me near to you, will make me closer to you. So loving the actions that Allah loves will also increase your love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now there is an ayah in the Quran. And the scholars call it Ayatul Mihna. It is the ayah that tests your love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you want to know if you love Allah or not, this is the ayah. It's like a litmus test. It will tell you if you love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or not. And this ayah is related to number eight, like we just talked about. The ayah says, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهِ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهِ Say, if you claim, I know many people claim that, we love God, we love God, God, love. They do it all the time. Here it says, If you truly love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then follow the messenger of Allah. Follow me, meaning follow the messenger of Allah, and Allah will love you. And you read the verse in the beginning, you say, what is the relationship? What is the relationship between loving Allah and following the messenger? What is the, I mean, let me ask you, what is the relationship? Why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala link loving Allah to following the sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam? I've been talking for too long, so you gotta help me now. I mean, is there a relationship at all? Loving Allah, following the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Here he made it a condition. Like, you claim it, well, let us see if the claim is true or not. If you follow the sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salam, and by sunnah I mean, you know, everything about the Prophet, not just, I mean, some people may focus only on one or two aspects of the sunnah. I mean, every part of the sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salam. If you look in the books of sunnah, you know, it covers every possible aspect of the Prophet's life. You know, there's some books about the shama'il, the character of the Prophet, what he used to like and not like, his moral behavior, his, you know, qualities, everything about the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. What is the relationship between that and loving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Come on, it's not too hard. Anybody? Well, let me give you a hint. As humans, is there any way for us to know what Allah likes and what He doesn't like? Like, if we want to know what actions Allah likes, what acts Allah likes and what acts He doesn't like, can we tell? I mean, if there were no prophets, no messengers, nothing at all, using our knowledge, our whatever, knowledge, science, what have you, can we tell what Allah likes and what He doesn't like? Can we tell what action, like I have an action here in front of you. Can you tell me if that's, if this action is loved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or not? Can we? No, we can't. This is a knowledge that only a prophet can tell us. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the prophets. Because they're going to do the actions that Allah loves. And this is why when we follow the prophet, really in essence, what are we doing? We are actually doing the actions that Allah loves. Whatever the Prophet did, وَمَا أَتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ فَخُذُوهُ وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُ. Whatever the Prophet did, you do and you follow. Whatever he avoided, you avoid. Why? Again. Because what he did was beloved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The actions he did were actions that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loved. Whatever he avoided were actions that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not love or he did not like. So in essence, when we follow the Prophet alayhi salam, when we follow the sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salam, in essence what we're doing is we are enacting, we're doing the actions that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves. And this is why at the end of the ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, يُحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهِ. If you do this, if you follow the Prophet's example, if you follow the sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salam, what's going to happen, Allah will love you. And that's very important, because in the beginning of the ayah it says, if you love Allah, if you claim that you love Allah, so it's about you loving Allah. At the end of the verse, it's talking about Allah loving you, which is far greater. It's one thing that you love Allah, which is great. But the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves you is far greater. And the, you know, this, this concept of loving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mutual. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about that. He said, يُحِبُّهُمْ وَيُحِبُّونَ. So he talks about people that love Allah and Allah loves them in return. So usually it's a mutual relationship. You love Allah, Allah loves you. But the fact that Allah loves you is far greater. The fact that Allah, who is not in need of you, the fact that He loves you is far greater. But that's actually the outcome of following the sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. So these are eight you know, steps or eight, if you will, you know, ways or methods of improving and increasing our love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now I want somebody to repeat those eight. Any volunteers? In the back, front? Sure, go ahead. Oh no, you can't use notes. That's cheating. Yeah, I mean, so let's, I mean, we don't have, you know, we can, inshallah, split so not one person has to say all eight, but maybe each one or one, you know, eight people will say, you know, eight. And I know the first few will have it easy, but the last one will be the hardest. Yes, that's number one. To recite the Quran, is it any recitation or is it with reflection, contemplation, tadabbur, as the Quran says it? And you read it with an open mind, so you're not telling the Quran what it's supposed to mean. The Quran is telling you what you're supposed to believe and practice. So that's number one. What is number two? Okay, so we don't have to do it in order. So knowing the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Like I said, you know, if you love anyone, you gotta know about them. There's no way you could love someone without knowing about them. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, He told us about Himself. And the Prophet alayhi salam was the most knowledgeable about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said in a hadith, أَلَا إِنِّي أَعْلَمُكُمْ بِاللَّهِ وَأَتْقَاكُمْ لَهِ. I am the most knowledgeable of your Lord. So the Prophet alayhi salam was the most knowledgeable about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this ma'rifah will inherit, as the scholars say, تُوَرَّثَ الْحُبْ. It will inherit love in your heart. So that is number two, which is knowing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through His names and attributes. Okay, number three. Yes, over there. Do a nafl, excellent. Do a nafl, which is doing the voluntary acts of worship. That will increase your love of Allah. Like we mentioned, the hadith where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks, hadith Qudsi, وَلَا يَزَالُ عَبْدِي يَتَقَرَّبُ إِلَيَّ بِالنَّوَافِلْ حَتَّى أُحِبَّهُ. That my servant will keep doing these voluntary acts of worship until I love him. So that is number three. Okay, next. You already spoke, right? You only get one chance. No, you already mentioned one, or no? You did. Okay, so good company. So, JazakAllah khair. So yes, keeping a good company. Because what we mean by that, excuse me, good company means that you find the people who love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you keep, you know, you have, you know, you make friends with them. Because if they love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it will inherit, you know, the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in your heart. It will affect you. Good company will affect you. Yes.
Think about the bounties of Allah.
Yes, absolutely. To think about the favors and the bounties of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon us will increase our love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How many do we have so far? Four or five? Maybe? Four? Okay. Conservative. More, okay. Over there. Go ahead. Yes. You telling me the number? Okay. What's up? Yes. Choosing what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves and desires over our desire. The women have not spoken. Yes. Following the footsteps of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, following the sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of course. To remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on a regular basis. You know, one hadith, one companion came to the Prophet alayhi salam and asked for an advice, and the Prophet said, لَا يَزَالُ لِسَانُكَ رَطْبًا مِنْ ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ. That your tongue is always wet with the mention of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Which means it's done on a regular basis. I mean, we cannot be like the angels. The angels are mentioning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala every minute, every second. يُسَبِّحُونَ اللَّيْلَ وَالنَّهَارَ لَا يَفْتُرُونَ. They're making tasbih day and night. And it says, لَا يَفْتُرُونَ. They don't stop. Non-stop dhikr. We cannot do that. But, you know, you can do something like make sure every day you mention Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the morning, in the evening, you know, in between. So that's, inshallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will count you from al-dhakirin. Is that it? Or did we miss any? Is it? Okay. To love those who love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you mentioned that, the good company, that's the same. And she mentioned the following the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, which is doing the actions that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves. So I think we're good, we're covered. So I hope we all remember that. Like I said, maybe you cannot implement all of them, but let's try to implement some of them at least as much as possible. And I hope, inshallah, in this blessed night that we can do some of that. But it's a long-term thing about Ramadan. Not everything you do in Ramadan, but Ramadan gives you a huge boost in Iman so that after Ramadan you can keep going for a long time. So I hope, you know, we can work on this at least long-term. We have to work on our love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to increase it, improve it, inshallah, so that our worship will make much more sense. Our worship will have, you know, a core, an essence. Because it's the most important element in worship. So I hope that we can do as much of this as possible. Jazakumullah khair. And, I don't know if you have any quick comments or questions about this, but do we take questions? Are we allowed? Is it okay?
Yeah.
Okay, go ahead. No. So the question was, how do we tell about Laylatul Qadr that it happened? Are there any signs of Laylatul Qadr? Wallahu alam, I mean, during the time of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, there were certain signs. For example, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam dreamt in one Ramadan that he's going to be prostrating in rain and mud. And we know the dream of the Prophet has to come true. Not like our dreams. Our dreams can come true sometimes, but the dream of the Prophet has to come true. So he prostrated, and I believe in that hadith it says it was the night of the 21st, which tells us that the night of Qadr does not have to be on the 27th. Now it's more likely to be on the 27th because we have other narrations. But for that particular Ramadan, he saw himself prostrating in mud and rain, and it did happen. It rained so hard, you know, the Masjid of the Prophet ﷺ, it had a ceiling, but not the ceilings we have now. So rain could go through. And he was indeed prostrating, exactly like he saw in a dream, with the mud and water. So this was a sign. But these signs, you know, you might say they were limited to the time of the Prophet ﷺ, because none of us is a prophet now, so we can't tell. But there are hadith that indicates certain signs, Allahu A'lam, like the fact that you feel peace during the night. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us in Surah Al-Qadr, Salamun hiya hatta matla' al-fajr. So, you know, you can feel peace and tranquility. Also part of that is, and some scholars mentioned this, that in the morning, the sun will not have any rays. Now this, we have to maybe explain it a little bit better. Yani, some scholars mention the reason because of this, the reason this happens is because there's so many angels. Now, it could be that the way we perceive it, for example, we look at the sun and we don't see it as, you know, shining as usual. Allahu alam, I don't know, you know, how exactly you can spot that, but the idea is that the angels are blocking maybe at least part of the sun or the rays coming from the sun. Allahu alam. But that's one sign that some scholars mention. But I think maybe the most important sign is the peace, the tranquility, because that is mentioned in the Quran. It says, Salamun hiya hatta matla' al-fajr. So that is something you can feel during the night. And this is why I mentioned in the khutbah that we should avoid fighting as much as possible during those nights. I mean, everything else is, we should not fight any time, but especially during these nights. You know, because one time, there were two people who fought during Laylatul Qadr, and the Prophet said that Laylatul Qadr was taken away, or like the knowledge of Laylatul Qadr was taken away. Maybe the Prophet was told that this night was going to be Laylatul Qadr, but because people were fighting, that knowledge was taken away. So I think the most obvious sign of Laylatul Qadr, the night of Qadr, is this peace you find, salam, the peace and tranquility, this something, you know, you feel inside, you feel around you, surrounds you, feeling of, you know, relief and, you know, you feel better in general. And, you know, this is not, science, so it might differ from one person to another. Allahu Akbar.